I wanted to present the bibliography, the different papers that I will use and refer to in this talk. So first, the paper by Bartel Livné, one of the first papers on modular representation, mod-p representation of GL2 of periodic field. Then a paper of Breuil on, in French, on modular representation, supersingular modular representation of GL2QP, where appeared at first semi-simple mod P Langlands correspondence. And then a famous paper on Colmes and relation between phi gamma modules and representation of GL2QP. And two papers of Emerton that I will speak about later. And the paper of Van Jacob. It is related to what I was speaking in the last lecture on the dimension of this admissible representation from the point of view of Iwasawa theory. Okay, so let me first continue what I was saying last time. Perhaps I will switch off the camera because you will see only half of my face anyway. So if you still see the screen, it's okay. So I wanted to complete what I was saying about dimensions of admissible representation of a p-adic Lie group G. So if you have pi v such a representation, so I explained that there exists some compact open subgroup open propi subgroup in G such that the graded algebra of the completed group algebra of H is a polynomial algebra in D variable where D is the dimension of the group G. So this was the result of Lazar. And then the dimension of this representation, which is also called Gelfand-Kirilov dimension, can be computed geometrically in terms of the support of the graded module of the dual of the representation, its support being a closed subset of the spectrum of the graded algebra of the completed group algebra, which is now isomorphic to the spectrum of commutative rings, so we have a good notion of support. And so on. And in fact, here we take the graded module. I didn't say it for the MH-adic filtration on V-dual. So V-dual is a finitely generated module over this completed group algebra. If we take its MH-adic filtration, where MH is the maximal ideal of the computed group algebra, then we obtain a finitely generated graded module over a commutative ring, and we can compute its Gelfand-Kirilov dimension as being the dimension of the support of this module. And some application linked to another description, which is a consequence of the notion of Hilbert-Samuel multiplicity of a finitely generated module over a Noetherian graded algebra is that there exists some integer, which is a non-positive integer, I, such that if in V you consider the subset of vectors which are killed by some power of this maximal ideal, then the dimension of this space, which is a finite dimensional vector space over F, is growing polynomially with degree this dimension exactly. So it is equivalent to n to the power corresponding to this, with the power corresponding to this dimension when n is growing to the infinity. So in fact, this Gelfand-Kirilov dimension measures the growing of invariant vectors in some admissible smooth representation of G. So, okay. So that's another interpretation of this dimension. Okay, so I think that's all about all I wanted to say about this dimension generalities about smooth representation of periodically groups. And now I will speak about the situation for the group GL to QP, and more precisely about the mod P Langlands correspondence. For a very particular periodically group, which is the group GL2QP. So in order to describe what is the mod P Langlands correspondence for this group, we need first to list the irreducible smooth representation of this group. So here, always over F, which is the finite field of characteristic P that I fixed at the beginning of the first lecture. So this irreducible smooth representation were classified by the work of Bartel and Livnet, and of Breuil, and of Berger. Actually, Bartel, Livnet, and Breuil gave the classification of irreducible smooth representation of GL2QP with a central character, and Berger proved later that all this representation, all this irreducible representation, have a central character. Okay, so how to describe this representation? First, we have some representation for the principal series. Which are the following. Let chi be a let chi be some character of QP star in F star. So I will always consider locally constant character. So such a character has a time part and some unramified part. So to define them, we decompose QP star as the product of ZP star times the powers of P. Because this character is locally constant and the group F star has a cardinal which is prime to P, it will factor through the quotient of ZP star, the FP star quotient of ZP star. And it will decompose as a product of two characters. So I will use the following notation. I will denote omega, the character of QP star in F star, which factors through, okay, which is induced by the inclusion of SP star in F star, and which is trivial on P to the Z, so it is trivial on P. And if lambda is an element of F star, I will use the notation u r of lambda to denote the unramified character sending P over lambda. So unramified means that it is trivial on ZP star. Okay, and now if I fix two of these characters, I can use them to define a character of the upper Borel subgroup of GL to QP, which is a subgroup of upper triangular matrices, by the following formula, K1 times K2 of a matrix ABCD is the product of K1 of A and K2 of D. And now we have a character of B, and as I explained in the first lecture, we can induce it to construct a representation of GL to QP. So we can induce it from B to G. So here G will be always the group GL to QP in this talk. We can induce this character to obtain a smooth representation of GL to QP. And it follows for the results of Bartel and Nivenet that this representation is irreducible most of the time, if and only if the two characters K1 and K2 are equal, or if the difference between these two characters is the unramified character sending P on P minus 2. Actually, it is the norm to the square over QP star. Okay, and what happening in these two situations, actually this parabolic induction will break into two parts. So for example, if K1 is equal to K2, it's equal to 1, then this the parabolic induction of the trivial character contains a non-trivial sub-representation, which is just a trivial representation corresponding to constant function over G, and it has some quotient, which is called the special representation, which is actually irreducible. Okay, and with this two representation, I can give the complete list of irreducible representation of GL2 of QP coming from the principal series. Actually, in the case where the two characters chi and chi2 are equal to some character chi, the Donalder factors of this parabolic induction are just the one-dimensional trivial representation of GL2 QP corresponding to the composition of the determinant with this chi, and the special representation tensored by this character. So actually, we have two irreducible subquotients, which are these two representations. And in the case where k1 minus k2 is the square of the norm, then it is, for example, the case of the parabolic induction of chi ties the norm, tensor with chi times the norm to the minus 1. And in fact, these two parabolic inductions are not isomorphic, but they have the same Jordan-Hölder factors, which are still this one-dimensional representation and this special representation tensored with chi, which is infinite dimensional. Okay, so that gives us a list of principal series. We have these characters, this special representation tensored by characters, and irreducible parabolic induction. But
to correct your notes,
other representation.
Benjamin?
Yes.
To correct your notes, Marie-France has pointed out that on the second line, you mean reducible.
Sorry?
On the second line?
Yes.
You mean reducible? There's some chat happening. These are the cases where this thing breaks up into two Jordan-Hölder factors. Reducible.
Ah, yes, thanks. That's the converse. Yeah. If and if not. So, yeah. Yes, yeah. Thank you very much. Yes, it's reducible if and only if we are in this, this case. Thank you. Sorry for that. Okay, so yes. And so the other irreducible representation are called super-singular representation. And by definition, they are the irreducible ones which are not in the previous list. Irreducible representation, which are not subquotient of this parabolic induction, in this parabolic induction. So actually, these super singular representations were classified by Breuil in the case of GL2QP. And I will give you not a complete description of them, but at least the classification. Fix sigma be a weight of the compact periodically group K, which is in our case GL2ZP. So as we see, we saw in Fred's lecture, this weight are irreducible representation of K. And because the kernel of the reduction mod P from ZP to GL2ZP to GL2FP is a proppy group, it will act irreducibly. So a weight for us is an irreducible representation of K. So the kernel of this map will act trivially on sigma. So because the representation is irreducible, the action will factor through GL2FP. And so the irreducible representation of GL2ZP are actually the irreducible representation of GL2FP, which already appeared in Fred's lecture. So such a weight is isomorphic to the symmetric power of the regular representation of GL2 over F, tensored by some power of the determinant. And R is an integer between 0 and pi minus 1. And we can choose M being between 0 and pi minus 2. So when we have such a weight, we can define another weight, which is called sigma S. And this sigma S is kind of companion weight. It is the sim pi minus 1 minus R tensor with the determinant of M plus R. So what is the meaning of this weight? Actually, the weight is almost characterized by its invariant under the upper unipotent subgroup of GL2. So you have a torus which acts on it, and this torus acts by some character. Let's call it psi. And most of the time, this character characterizes the weight. And actually, this weight sigma s will have highest weight s of sigma, where s is this matrix. So that's why I'm using this notation to define this weight. Okay, and the main theorem concerning the classification of this super singular representation is the following. For such a weight, there exists a unique super singular representation of GL2QP such that its K circle, so let's call it pi of sigma is equal to sigma plus sigma s. So the K circle is the largest semi-simple K sub-representation of pi. So actually, if I denote K1, the kernel of the reduction mod pi. If a representation is admissible, then this K1 being a normal subgroup of GL to ZP will act semi-simply on this circle, but since it is a propy group, it will act trivially, so the circle is anyway always contained in the K1 invariant of a representation pi. So this implies in particular that all these representations, these super singular representations are admissible. I'm a bit confused. I'm not used to this. That's the first part. Sorry, that's the first part of the theorem. And the second part is that a super singular representation of GL to QP is isomorphic to a twist of this previous representation to pi of sigma tensored with chi composed with the determinant for some character chi of QP star. So up to twist, we have the list of all supersingular representations of GL to QP. And as a corollary, all irreducible representation representations of GL to QP smooth representation are admissible. So the reason here is that the, as I said, the K-circle of pi sigma that's a bit more complicated. Yes, so I don't want to give more details about this this corollary. So proof, how can we deduce this from the theorem of Breuil? Actually, if you take some, in fact, the parabolic induction are admissible. And then you have to check it for a supersingular representation. And by the previous theorem, you know that their K-circle is finite dimensional. Okay. And now if you choose K1, the first congruence subgroup, so which is the kernel of the reduction mod P from GL to ZP to GL to FP. So it is a propy group. And in order to prove that your representation is admissible, you have to check that the K1 invariant vectors are finite dimensional over F. But now this is a representation of K mod K1, which is a finite group isomorphic to GL2 of FP. And the K circle of pi is isomorphic to the K circle k mod k1 circle of this representation of a finite group. And we know that if a representation of a finite group has a finite dimensional circle, then it is finite dimensional. So it means that this space is finite dimensional. Okay. So that's for the classification of irreducible smooth representation of GL2QP. So when we have this classification, we can try to define by hand a semi-simple mod P Langlands correspondence for GL2 of QP. So the idea of mod P Langlands correspondence is to relate on one side the two-dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP, so on F vector space, F vector spaces. With, on the other side, some, I will explain why, some semi-simple representation of GL2QP. So here I should add semi-simple. So the list of two-dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP is easy to do. So you have first the irreducible representation, which are the induction from the absolute Galois group of QP squared to the absolute Galois group of QP of some power of ser fundamental character of order 2. So they are of this form up to twist. For instance, I define everything up to twist. So for some r between 0 and p minus 1. And Breuil proposed to associate to this two-dimensional Galois representation the supersingular representation of GL2QP corresponding to the ser weight sim to the r of f squared. And if the representation is reducible, so up to twist, it is of the following form. Some power of the cyclotomic character, which is fundamental ser weight of fundamental weight of weight one, which is via class field theory. I will just write them as character of QP square. And I will compose with the local reciprocity map of class field theory. And so Breuil proposed to associate to this reducible representation not a parabolic induction but a direct sum of two parabolic induction, and the direct sum is the following. So the fact is that in characteristic P, you don't have intertwinings between. So it's not a direct sum; it's a tensor product. You don't have intertwinings between principal series. So you have to take both of them. In fact, and because they are not necessarily irreducible, you take their semi-simple, the direct sum of their Jordan-Hölder factors, which is a semi-simplification of this representation. And so, plus, you add the rule that if you twist a Galois representation with some character, then you obtain a representation of GL2, which is twisted by the composite of the character with the determinant. And so with this rule, you can define a semi-simple mod P Langlands correspondence, which is a bijection between isomorphism classes of two-dimensional semi-simple representation of the absolute Galois group of QP and some semi-simple representation of GL2 of QP, which are either irreducible supersingular representation or a direct sum of the Jordan-Hölder factors of all the of two principal series.
Benjamin, there's an R on the left also, right, in the second line?
Yes.
This direct sum, the reducible case.
Maybe yes.
Omega to the R plus one, maybe, or something.
Yes, sorry. Sorry, I forgot. Oh, okay. Very sorry. I forgot the power of the cyclotomic character. Okay, and so why this? Okay, so it is a really handy construction. So why this should be the good construction? Actually, it is related to the weight part of the Serre conjecture. So let me do some remark to justify this, this correspondence. Actually, when Breuil defined this correspondence, I think it was also motivated by a relationship with the classical Langlands correspondence in characteristic zero and its reduction mod P. But there is another reason which is linked to the weight part of Serre correspondence, Serre conjecture. Sorry. So most of the time, I don't want to be really precise here because I will give some more precise statement later. You can check that if rho is a two-dimensional semi-simple Galois representation. And if pi rho is the corresponding pi rho semi-simple, corresponding semi-simple representation of GL2QP, then if you consider the socle of this representation pi of rho, and you twist it by the cyclotomic character composed with determinant minus one, so you have semi-simple representation of K, so it is a direct sum of weights. So you can take the list of all these weights, they are the Jordan-Hölder factor of this representation, and this list of weights coincide with the list of expected of Serre weights associated to the representation rho. So I'm saying most of the time, because when the supersingular, when the induced representation are not irreducible, you will have some small finite dimensional pieces that you don't want to count in this equality. So it's only in generic situations that you have this, but it is okay. A very good it is a very good reason to define the semi-simple Langlands correspondence in this way. So, for example, I described the socle of some irreducible super singular representation, but it's really easy to compute the circle of some parabolic induction. And if you compute this this circle, for example, from the circle of this parabolic induction will be exactly and you have perhaps and you twist it with the cyclotomic character minus one. This circle is the weight sim to the r of s square. So you can check that this correspondence at the level of circle really fits with the weight part of the Serre conjecture for GL2QP. Okay, so that's for the semi-simple part, but unfortunately, we don't want to work only with semi-simple representation. And this correspondence can be extended to the non-semi-simple case. Using what we called Colmes-Montréal functor. So what is this functor? So actually, it's a construction of Colmes. He constructed a functor from the category of smooth admissible finitely generated representation of GL2QP, which is going towards a category of finite dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP bar, of QP. Okay, and how is constructed this functor? This functor is constructed via the category of étale phi gamma modules. So the category of étale phi gamma modules is a category which is equivalent via the theory of Fontaine to the category of representation of the absolute Galois group QP. And the first step is to associate to representation of GL2QP some étale phi gamma module. So actually, the construction of Colmes is essentially this one. It is constructed a functor, which an exact functor, which associates to some representation pi, a phi gamma module d of pi. And here, to go from étale phi gamma module to Galois representation, it is the theory of Fontaine. So I will just perhaps I will recall what is a phi gamma module. A phi gamma module in this lecture is a finite dimensional vector space over the field of Lorentz series with coefficient in P, which has an additional structure. First, it has some Frobenius endomorphism, so D, let's say D, it has phi F linear endomorphism. So it is not F parenthesis X linear, but is satisfied, it is semi-linear for the Frobenius endomorphism. Namely, it satisfies this relation for each Lorentz series S of X. So it is a phi and some continuous action of the group gamma. So gamma is the group ZP star in the F linear endomorphism of D. And this action is also linear, semi-linear, in the sense that an element A of ZP star acts on S of X times M by the following rule. It sends actually X on 1 plus x to the a minus 1 times a times a. And the actions of gamma and phi have to commute. And we say that a phi gamma module is etal. If, so this map is not F parenthesis X linear, but you can extend it to a linear map by extension of scalars. So you obtain in this way a map which is linear over this field F parenthesis X, and if this map is an ISO. Okay. So actually, phi is a kind of descent data over D for the Frobenius. Okay, so now what is how this functor is constructed? Construction of the functor pi sent to D of pi. So it is a perhaps this is a construction of Colmes, but I will use the presentation of Emerton to construct this functor. So you start with pi v, which is an admissible finitely generated representation of GL2QP. And you can view it first of all, it is V is an F bracket X module. If you identify F bracket X with the Iwasawa algebra of the propy group ZP, ZP being identified to a subgroup of GL2QP like this. So we identify ZP to the subgroup of upper unipotent representation in this coefficient in ZP. So because V is a smooth representation of GL2QP, it is a smooth representation of this group, and then V is a smooth F bracket X module, meaning that each vector is killed by some open ideal of this algebra. So you have an action of an endomorphism F. We call it F in the F linear endomorphism of V, which is given by the action of the matrix P1. And actually, V becomes a module over the non-commutative algebra, which is the algebra of non-commutative polynomial with coefficient in this power series ring and with variable f with relation f times x equals to x to the p times f. So it is a non-commutative algebra, but the relation in the group GL2QP, which is given by this formula, tells you that with this that V is naturally an A module. Okay, so you let F act by this endomorphism, you let X act through this identification, and you obtain a structure of A module over your smooth representation V. Okay, and so now what is the idea of the construction? The idea is to begin by fixing some W V in V. So W is a finite dimensional F vector space, which generates pi V as a representation of GL2QP. And you consider now the sub A module generated by W in V. It is a sub module generated by the vector space W. And the main input now, the main structure result, which is due to Colmes and we proved by Emerton, is that this M, so M is an A module, so it is in particular a F bracket X module, so it is a smooth representation of ZP, is admissible as a representation of ZP. I recall that we identify here ZP with the subgroup of upper unipotent matrices in GL2 of ZP. And what does this mean? This means that its dual, M, is finitely generated over the Iwasawa algebra of ZP, which is our F bracket X. Okay, so it's a finitely generated module, and then you obtain a finite dimensional F bracket X vector space if we invert X. Finite dimensional vector space. Over this field. So now we have the space of the Feiger module. We just have to define phi and gamma. And actually, the action of phi and gamma will come from the action of the matrix P1 over V and the diagonal subgroup. And this diagonal subgroup, which is isomorphic to gamma. So precisely, we have the following. So we have the map F. I recall that it is given by the action of P1 over M. And because M is finitely generated over A, So this map is not is a semi-linear map of Fx modules. So you can linearize it as before, by some base change and you obtain some map of, it is really a map of Fx module now. It is a linear map of Fx modules. And because M is a finitely generated A module, you can deduce that its co-kernel, is a finitely generated Fx module, but because M is a submodule of a smooth representation, it is also torsion. So if you have a f bracket x module which is finitely generated and torsion, it is finite. So what is the purpose of this? This is that now you can dualize this map to construct your file. So you obtain a map from the dual of M. This, which is a map of f bracket x module with a finite kernel. So if it has a finite kernel, it will be an ISO when you invert x. Okay. And in fact, this, I forgot to inverse x. And so this is our Feiger module, d of pi. And this is, after some careful, okay, we have to be a bit careful in the sign isomorphism, but it is the extension of scalar of this Feiger module to fx along this map, x, along the relative Frobenius. And so you obtain an isomorphism, which is not phi, it is the inverse of phi. So you define phi as being the inverse, and you obtain some etal phi module. And now for the action of gamma. If you want to define the action of gamma, you just choose W, the generating F vector space, stable under the compact group that P star isomorphic to the diagonal group isomorphic to this P star, which is possible since the representation is smooth. And in this case, you can check that M will be stable under this group, and you inherit an action of gamma on this phi module, and at the end you obtain an etal phi gamma module. So at the end, what you obtain, the theorem of Colmes, is that this functor D is an exact and contravariant, because there is some duality inside, some etal contravariant functor from the category of admissible, smooth, and finitely generated representation of GL2QP to the category of continuous representation of the absolute Galois group of QP on F vector spaces. Finite dimensional F vector spaces. Okay, and moreover, you can check. So, that yes, if you, it is compatible with the semi-simple Langlands correspondence. That now, if rho is two-dimensional two-dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP, then if you apply the functor, so Fontaine functor to, so you take the semi-simple representation of GL2QP associated by Breuil to rho, you apply Colmes functor to obtain a Feiger module, and you obtain Fontaine functor to obtain a Galois representation, then this Galois representation is isomorphic. Is isomorphic to all. Okay, so now it gives us a way to go from functorial way to go from the category of admissible smooth representation of GL to QP. So it contains the reducible one because they are finitely generated to the category of finite dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP. And then the second theorem of Colmes is that this extends to the non-semi-simple case, namely if rho is a two-dimensional representation of the absolute Galois group of QP, not necessarily semi-simple. There exists a unique admissible and finitely generated representation of GL to QP, such that if you apply this functor to pi, let me give it, I want to give it a name, pi of rho, you recover rho. But for the unicity, I have to add some condition such that pi of rho has no finite dimensional subobject or quotient. Actually, you can check on the construction of this functor D that D will kill everything which is finite dimensional. So if you add something finite dimensional as a subobject or as a quotient, you don't change the image by the functor. So you can really choose the minimal such a representation. And this is what we call pi of rho. And that's essentially the statement of the Langlands, the mod p Langlands correspondence for GL to QP. So what is very nice is that this correspondence can be realized through a functor, an exact functor. And because we have this functor, we can apply it to deformations of objects on both sides. And that's this property which permitted to Kizin and Emerton to use the p-adic Langlands correspondence to prove results on deformation rings of Galois representations. So now I would like to mention the link with the modular curves and the completed cohomology. Link with completed cohomology of modular curves. So which is due to Emerton. So fix n an integer, so let's say bigger than 5 and prime to p. Then we can consider the completed cohomology of the tower of modular curves, but now with mod p coefficients, so I chose it with coefficient in F, the finite field I fixed before, so you can really view it as the extension of scalar of the completed cohomology considered in Stefano lecture to F. So on this space, you have a smooth action of GL to QP. And if it is constructed with the Ethal cohomology, you also recover an action of the absolute Galois group of Q. And now fix rho bar some modular representation of the absolute Galois group of Q, a two-dimensional one. So assume that it is absolutely reducible odd and unramified almost everywhere. So in that case, we know that it is modular by the work of Carré, Vintembergès. And then what you can do is to consider the Robart isotypic subspace of this completed cohomology, which is defined as the Galois equivariant homomorphism of Robart in this space of completed cohomology. And then, because the action of Galois and the action of GL2 commute, you obtain an action of GL2 QP on this space. And the local global compatibility theorem of Emerton states that under some, I want to state first the theorem and just moderate the hypothesis next, because it's not the most important thing. That actually, if you apply Colmes functor to this, Robart isotypic part in the completed cohomology, what you obtain, and you have to twist by some character, insert with a twist of the cyclotomic character, you recover exactly Robart. So it means that it is a restriction of Robart to a decomposition group at P, of course. So it means that the mod P local Langlands correspondence can be realized in the completed cohomology of modular curves. So I should precise the actual hypothesis under which this theorem is verified. You have to assume that P is larger than 2 and that the restriction of Robart to a Galois group is not isomorphic neither to an extension of the trivial representation by itself, or a twist of the extension of the trivial representation, the cyclotomic character by the trivial representation, up to twist. Okay, if you avoid these two situations, then you have this local global compatibility. Okay, so I wanted to explain what is the relation between this local global compatibility and the white part of the Serre conjecture. But I think I will stop now because I'm a bit late. And I will finish explaining this tomorrow. And tomorrow, I will also explain what is the situation in the case of GL2, a finite extension of QP. And because we are very far from this nice situation, and what are the partial results we know actually in this situation. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Benjamin, for a very clear lecture. Are there any questions?
Yeah, so I have one question. So yes. How would you define this completed cohomology for the mod p coefficients? Because in Mora's lecture, he always took coefficient and characteristic zero field.
In this case, it's just the reduction mod p. So I think because you have this completed cohomology with coefficient in Zp, say, you have some integral lattice inside it, and you just take the reduction mod p. So in fact, there is a most simpler way to define it in this case. It is just the inductive limit over all powers of p of the cohomology of modular curves of level n times p to the n. So you just let the level vary at p and you take the inductive limit. Okay. Yeah. And okay. It is actually in the situation of curves, it is the reduction mod p of some integral lattice in the completed cohomology of Stefano's lecture.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
So is there hope of doing this mod powers of P, not mod P? For representations, mod powers of P?
Yes, yes, exactly. Actually, I didn't mention it because I wanted to focus on the mod P situation, but the functor of Colmes can apply to a representation of GL2QP over Artinian ring like Z mod P to the N. And so you can deform, you can use this functor to deform the situation mod P to this situation on Artinian rings. And then you can go to the limit and obtain things about on ZP and even QP.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Comments? Okay, so thank you, Benjamin, once more, and we will reconvene in about 22 minutes. Thank you.